हाय गाइस, गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। माय नेम इज़ अनुज जिंदल और आज हम लोग बात करने वाले हैं एक सक्सेसफुल लेक्चरर से हु इज़ टीचिंग इन खालसा कॉलेज इन दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी। आप सभी, बहुत सारे स्टूडेंट सोचते होंगे कि एम कॉम के बाद या अपने मास्टर्स प्रोग्राम के बाद या फिर एमबीए के बाद हाउ डू यू प्रोसीड फर्दर इन योर टीचिंग करियर, इन योर लेक्चरशिप करियर। इट साउंड्स एंड इट लुक्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ वेरी लिटिल गाइडेंस दैट इज़ अवेलेबल आउट देयर। कीपिंग दैट इन माइंड, दिस न्यू सीरीज हैज़ बीन क्रिएटेड जिसके अंदर हम बहुत सारे ऐसे लेक्चरर्स के से बात करेंगे, बहुत सारे प्रोफेसर से बात करेंगे। एंड द आइडिया इज़ वेरी सिंपल, टू हेल्प यू गाइज अंडरस्टैंड हाउ कैन यू मूव फॉरवर्ड इन योर करियर पाथ, हाउ कैन यू चॉक आउट योर ओन करियर पाथ एंड बी सक्सेसफुल इन लाइफ। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक विद मिस कोमल चिकारा अ लिटिल बिट अबाउट हर बिफोर वी मूव विद द क्वेश्चन। कोमल चिकारा डिड हर और फाइनलाइज हर मास्टर्स इन कॉमर्स फ्रॉम दिल्ली स्कूल ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स इन 2016। इन 2015 इटसेल्फ व्हाइल शी वाज परसुइंग हर मास्टर्स शी क्वालिफाइड हर जेआरएफ जूनियर रिसर्च फेलोशिप। इन 2016 इटसेल्फ इमीडिएटली आफ्टर कंप्लीटिंग हर मास्टर्स शी एनरोल्ड इन एमफिल प्रोग्राम इन दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी इटसेल्फ व्हिच कंप्लीटेड इन 2019। फ्रॉम 2019 टू 2022 शी हैज बीन परसुइंग हर पीएचडी 2021 एंड शी इज bound to complete her PhD in 2022. And she's also working as a reviewer in various journals. Number one, International Journal of Applied Business and International Management. Number two, Fortune Institute of International Business, FIIB. And number three, AIB, Academy of International Business. So first of all, Komal, I think it's a great honor and it's wonderful to have you on the channel today, have you here today to talk about your journey, to talk about life as a lecturer and to talk about how can the budding students who are still thinking about how to get into lecturership can do the same. A little bit about you if you want to start with it, and then we'll move with the questions.
Sure. First of all, thank you so much, Anuj, for the lovely opportunity. So as you have correctly mentioned about my education, I belong to Sonipat, Haryana. I have done my schooling from there itself. But after that, I thought, let's move to a bigger city. And what better than Delhi nearby? So I did my graduation from Daulat Ram College. I have been a very studious bachcha from the initial school days and college days. So like in the graduation itself, I realized I have to go for the master's program. I enrolled, as you mentioned, in Delhi School of Economics, the Commerce Department. There I did my MPhil, currently pursuing my PhD, and that is all as far as my education is concerned.
So your journey from post-graduation to being a successful lecturer in Delhi, that has had its own ups and downs, as I remember. तो थोड़ा सा उसके बारे में डिस्कस करते हैं, बिकॉज इफ इट फील्स ऑल टू फेरी, ऑल टू सक्सेसफुल टू एवरीवन वाचिंग, तो लगेगा कि यार ये तो बहुत आसानी से हो गया सब कुछ, बट इट्स नॉट दैट। सो लेट्स टॉक अबाउट दैट एज वेल।
डेफिनेटली। सो द वेरी फर्स्ट हर्डल, आई हैव डन माय ग्रेजुएशन एज अ पास प्रोग्राम, इट वाज नॉट एन ऑनर्स प्रोग्राम। सो लाइक व्हेन वी हैड टू टेक एडमिशन इन मास्टर्स, हमको बताया गया दैट आपका 5% विल बी कट ऑफ। सो आई वाज लाइक दिस इज सो अनफेयर, आई हार्ड अर्न माय 85% एंड यू नो यू आर जस्ट डिडक्टिंग माय मार्क्स। सो आई वाज लाइक ओके फेयर इनफ, देयर वाज एन एंट्रेंस एग्जाम ऑप्शन, सो यू नो आई ऑप्टेड फॉर दैट ऑल्सो। एंड ओके, सिंस आई हैड बीन स्टडिंग इन द ग्रेजुएशन, सो आई मेड थ्रू दैट ऑल्सो। सो दैट वॉज अ वेरी फर्स्ट हर्डल। यू नो it was a tough competition, Delhi School of Economics. Getting through it is tough because you have competition from honors, from pass, from 70 odd colleges of Delhi University, and then you know, from all around India there are people. So that was the first thing. Then masters itself, you know, first year there were some subjects we were like, okay, we haven't, you know, economics for one, if I can recall, that was a bit you know, difficult to manage. And that was all okay, learning through the master's thing. In master's itself, we realized, okay, master's se kuch nahi hoga, graduation ho gaya hai, DSC ka tag aa gaya hai, but master's karke kya? So the seniors told us we have to go for another exam, which is the NET exam. So I started preparing. I was like, okay, now this is the next thing I have to do. So I started, looking for the exam in the first year itself. And in 2014 to 16 was my duration. In first year itself, I appeared for the paper, the NET-JRF exam. Okay, but then what now? Okay, the graduation, the post-graduation is done in 2016. I have the NET-JRF with me. And now I was like, so a little bit of background. I come from the family of teachers. So, it was not very unexpected of me to choose that particular line. However, I, in my heart, wanted to go for UPSC. So, especially, so I thought that I'll initially go for like that coaching and everything. So I appeared for the UPSC exam twice. And simultaneously, in the second year, I realized that I have to, this is not it. This is not happening. Okay. I'm not doing very well at what I thought. So now let's change the plan. Now let's do something that, I feel I can do. So I appeared for the MPhil and PhD interviews. The MPhil interview, I cracked through and I joined my MPhil program. There also, research was, I had seen that, I was not being good at very generalistic. So all these competitive exams are all about generalistic things. But I realized through my MPhil that I am good at specialization. So that is where I found that, okay, this is where I fit in. I, put all my heart and soul in my MPhil. And through that, I kind of got the shape that, okay, I was as, just like our youngsters, everyone, I was also lost at a point. But then I realized, no. This is where I should go. And from there, I did my MPhil. And then again, taking admission into PhD, just like the master's, just like the MPhil, it's again, a lot of competition from the seniors, from the juniors, from the entire country. So again, not that fairy of a journey, but yeah, sail through. So that's
what exactly attracted you towards lecturership, apart from being from a family of teachers? Apart from being a plan B, what exactly was it that you thought ki yaar nahi lecturership mein shayad maza aayega ye karke dekhte hain?
True. So the first thing when I would even prepare for my exams for UPSC itself, I would not only love to learn about the new things, what I especially saw in myself, and my friends used to keep telling me that you explain the concepts way better than the teachers at the coaching institutes. So it is where, my friends told me about me, and I also got to know, I love reading, I love studying, and I also like explaining things that I know to somebody else. So that is where I realized that I, teaching could be good for me. So that's another reason.
You just explored it and experimented with it. And that is when you figured out that.
True. That... Very much. A lot of my peers, they start teaching at, just after their master's. However, I took my time. I did my MPhil. I did not teach along with my MPhil. I started teaching in 2019 along with my PhD. So after 3 years of my master's. So, then I started at Hansraj. 1-2 papers I started with, and I realized, okay, this is what I'm liking. So this is what I'm going to stick with. That's how it went.
So you took your time. Masters kiya, masters ke baad thoda sa gap liya where you prepared for UPSC and simultaneously you started with your MPhil program. But bahut sare aise students hain who are confused either in their masters or even after their masters program as to how to pursue lecturership. Ab mujhe karna hai, I want to do it, but I don't know how to do it. Mujhe kisi ne bol diya ki aapko research paper likhna hai ya aapko PhD program ke liye proposal likhna hai. But I don't know how to do it. Nobody taught me in college, or even when they taught me, I was not listening probably. So what should students do in that case if they feel that they're clueless? Or sequence kya hona chahiye, koi masters kar rahe to, how should they proceed with their decision to pursue lecturership?
So before actually answering your question, I would just like to mention one thing. The junior batches, the young students that I'm teaching, they are much smarter than our generation. I have to admit that. they already know a lot of things because of the internet, because of, you know, the kind of information that they have. So like, let's say I am a student who have just joined, let's say Delhi School of Economics or any other university, I'm doing my master's. So if I realize that my passion is teaching, so the very first thing that I have to know about is the NET exam, because that is the minimum qualification, minimum exam that you have to clear. So like that, for that, we have to be, you know, start preparing for UGC NET exam for commerce, if that is the subject. And yes, as far as you mentioned research, it is very important to pay attention to the teachers when they are teaching, which generally does not happen. So in that case, what to do? There are, like, at, you know, at departmental levels, the teachers are usually doing a lot of projects. Okay. So I've seen that when students interact with their teachers, when they write papers under their guidance, that could be one of the ways, rather than learning from the books. What is research methodology, ABCD? Let's, you know, actually do it practically with the help of teachers. So that is one way you can approach your teachers, the professors. And if that is not possible, so then, and you want to just check whether you have an interest in, so, you know, in teaching, there is a conundrum. A lot of people are interested in teaching, but they're not interested in research. And over here, we have to see that teaching these days, after the new education policy and after the 2021, you know, the notification as well, PhD has been made compulsory, mandatory at the university level. Very soon it will be made mandatory for the college level as well. So, you know, it comes as a deal package. You can't have, you know, teaching and not have research. Okay, you can prolong it. You can do your PhD later. But, you know, you ultimately, it is going to be, you know, a part of what you are taking as a package at university teaching. So in research, as I mentioned, you can definitely take help of your teachers. You can start, you know, with basic books on research methodology. There's a paper also in master's. If you show interest in that paper, you can learn through that. And then definitely, like, try and write something. Unless you write, you will not realize, can you do that or can you not do that? So just try and write. Start with a small literature review paper. See, you know, if there is a topic that interests you, and then you can definitely carry forward, if that helps.
So, what I'm understanding is that you have a very good idea about research, and that is why you're able to explain all those things. But the first question that is coming in my mind as a layman, as a person who's never read or written any research paper, is how do I choose the topic? What is a literature review? How do I figure out whether the topic is new or old, whether the topic is going to be helpful or not? So if there was a learning program, if there was a specific program, let's say a short-term course kind of a thing on research, where in 4 weeks, 8 weeks, you could learn all these small things. Let's say you are back in college and there is a program running of this kind, let's say in college itself, a 4 week program, every Saturday you sit for 3-4 hours with some people like you who have experience in research and who can teach all these things from scratch. How do you think that would help? Because we are never interested in listening to teachers, but if somebody comes from outside, we are very interested.
I personally feel it will help tremendously because, you know, if so, I'll share my example. When I appeared for my PhD interview, there was a very senior professor and he straight away asked me, what is the conceptual framework of this paper? And I was like clueless because I just did my master's. I had no idea what that word meant. And so I just, you know, said things that I kind of, you know, didn't make sense at that point also. But it is there. You know, I wanted to tell that professor that we have not been taught. I do not know, but it is expected of me, especially in Delhi University and some other universities also. Kind of it is expected of you, since you are you know, opting for MPhil or PhD program, entering into research, you should do your homework. So the program that you are suggesting will be kind of the homework, and it has definitely, as you are mentioning, it has a lot of scope in that sense.
Right. Coming back to your college now, because I think bahut sare students interested honge ye samajhne mein ki bhai college mein hota kya hai, from the teacher's perspective, not from the student's perspective. So what is your routine like in college as a lecturer? Do you get to boss around and do you like it, or what exactly happens?
See, actually, it was all fun and game. You know, it was very fun when it was offline. Online has taken fun away from us. So now I, being a teacher, I have to compete with Instagram, you know, entertaining Instagram, the WhatsApp chats, the YouTube videos, the entertaining world of internet. So I am being, you know, I'm competing with so many entertaining things. So the classes, they are also, you know, we have to make sure that we are making it interesting for the students. Apart from the teaching, again, the fun has been taken away because the learning from the past 1 year has been, you know, it is work from home for us people. So that is how, you know, we are managing with the situation. That's that.
But otherwise, when it is offline, how is how does your day go by? Like, other than teaching, other than being with students, what all do you have to do? What all are the responsibilities?
Okay. So as a teacher, it totally depends upon you, your capabilities. So what is, you know, the scenario in Delhi University and other universities as well is there is a lack of young, you know, teachers, because the old teachers, they are there. They are the permanent faculties. But the problem with them is they are not very tech savvy. We people are very tech savvy. So we and, you know, we can deal with things much better as compared to our senior faculties. So, for example, I manage the social media cell of our college. So being the Instagram, Twitter, YouTube. So that is the thing that we do. And then there are other committees also that I'm a part of, like upgrading the website. So that is one thing. I am being involved in every single part, like how to, you know, showcase our website to the world. And then there are so many conferences and workshops that we have to organize for the development of the students. So that is another activity we keep, you know, doing for the students. That's all.
There was one question that I have always had in my mind when, even when I was a student, even when I was in graduation, I would look to look at some teachers, some lecturers who are, you know, so much fun to talk with, who are always interacting with students, always among the crowd. और कुछ खरूस टीचर हुआ करते थे जो आते थे पढ़ाते थे और चले जाते थे so is it true that if you want to you can stay young at heart in college because you are among the youth and this is one perk which is not available in any other industry in the entire world.
Very true, very true. So like for example, let's say corporate world, it is stressful. You see people who are very serious in everything. The university, the college, you see young, bright people full of energy. So you also are like, okay, I have to do something. So that definitely, you know, and also I tell you, the time is gone. Being a Kharoos teacher and everything, it doesn't work with the students of these days. It doesn't work that way. So that is also another point I would like to add.
Okay, so I have this very last question, which is probably a kind of a personal one. So a sequel to that question, are you, where do you put yourself? Are you the Kharoos teacher or are you the cool one? Or the third category where you think you are the cool one, but the students think otherwise?
Yes. So I believe like I would go with the latter one. I would like to believe at least that, you know, I try and not be the Kharoos one. Very recently, I took one of the semesters got ended and I took feedback from the students. So it is my policy that I do feedbacks mid-semester and at the end of the semester so that I get to know, you know, and I deliberately ask questions where I ask about my behavior, how I deal with the students. So through that, I have got comments that, yes, I've been very friendly. I have been listening to their problems and guiding them. So that is what I like to believe. But it could totally be because they want better internal assessment marks. So one can never know that way.
Wonderful, wonderful. I believe this is one area, one industry in the entire world where we can be an idealist for our entire lives, where we don't have to be practical anymore and we can enjoy life as it is, as it should be, right?
True, very much. True.
So that was all. I think this small session is going to help all of you understand better about lecturership, understand, have a better idea about how to pursue it, whether you can and you will enjoy it or not, what lies in it for you, whether it is made for you or not, and whether you should be a part of this industry, a part of this career as a personal and at a professional level as well. So that was all with Komal. Thanks a lot, Komal, for coming.
Thank you so much.
And it was really nice having you. You threw light on some very, very important aspects, especially related to research, which I think a lot of us often ignore when we are studying, doing our masters. So that was all. All the best, guys. Take care. Bye-bye.